Warning for the pitching competition. Ladies and gentlemen, John is here already. So please round of applause for John. Last one.
Thank you. I know the applause is not for me, but for the fact that I'm last. I will move through my presentation quickly so that we can avoid the global challenge of the Manila traffic. Okay. This is in your program. You can read who I am. Okay, it's not working. Where shall I point this? Over there. Okay. All right. I'm a citizen of this country. Used to live here. Now live here. Faced with that white stuff that I hate. I've got two messages for ITSO managers and TTO managers and those universities engaged in this activity. The first question is, does this tech transfer stuff with a lot of talk actually work? Okay? A lot of buzz about it, but you, all of you at the back of the room, you need to be able to stand up and demonstrate that this is a successful activity globally. I'm going to give you evidence for that. Okay, come on. Why is this not working? All right. I'm going to give a couple of American examples quickly. Bufferin. Crest toothpaste. Dave. For every 30 seconds this thing doesn't work, you should reduce paying their bill by 20%, okay? This is just nonsense. Gatorade from the University of Florida, Taxol from Florida State University, Papillon, University of Toronto, neckties from Florida State. Now, here are more important examples for you to know about and pay attention to. First one is in India. It's a case they collaborated with Cornell University. The field trials were done in India. Trait was transferred, and now eggplant distributed in Southeast Asia has this pest-resistant trait. Okay, successful technology transfer that you can eat. In South America, Pontifical University in Chile, the dean of engineering invented a piece of hardware which is an earthquake damping device. It's now over a $15 million a year business. The tallest building in South America has his damping equipment in it. And there are examples of his equipment on this side of the Pacific Ocean. You need to know about this. You need to be able to point it out to the people you talk to. But this activity works, and there are examples outside the United Kingdom, Canada, and the United States. This one you know about. How many here know about this one? The people at the back of the room don't have your hand up. You're going to get fired unless you know about this. Do you know about it? Raise your hands. You need to know about this local example. Okay? This is a very important example. You need to know about it. You need to be happy about it. The fact that it did not happen at your university is not relevant. The fact that it happened here in your country is highly relevant. It's a wonderful story about social impact. You need to know about it. All right. The second lesson is that part of your job responsibility is not for what you do currently, all these metrics and the day-to-day activity, but the fact that each of you has a responsibility to communicate the value of your activity. What I mean by that is this. If I went down those stairs and walked to the back of the room and asked one of you, invited one of you to come up here and talk about an interesting tech transfer project at your university, you should feel very comfortable and be able to do that on 30 seconds notice. If you're walking across campus and run into your rector, and your rector says, "What are you doing for me today?" you should have that on the tip of your tongue. You should be able to explain the benefit of a project you are working on. Not the technology, not the patent protection, nothing except the benefit, the potential benefit. You should have that on the tip of your tongue. You should be able to communicate that. Okay, a lot of conversation about metrics. This is important for internal consumption. You can break it down into inputs, outputs, and do an MBA type of thing. The inputs are the disclosures of patents, copyrights, outputs are there. You should be more concerned about what the outcomes are in terms of companies you're dealing with, even if you haven't done a deal. The number of startups that you're working on, research collaborations. So when you talk about what you're doing, these are the numbers you should have. I will tell you, nobody but people in government give, let me rephrase this, no one except the government cares about the KPIs of the metrics, the number of patents filed, okay? Your mothers, your fathers, your spouses, they don't care, okay? These, what they should care about and the way you communicate it is the potential benefit to the Filipino society, what you're working on. Those are the key things that you need to be able to communicate. And so we talk about the impacts. Again, the San Carlos story of quality of life improved is a key part. The fact that it happens elsewhere at another university is not relevant. The fact that it happens here in your country is highly relevant. Then you need to talk about income because people are curious. And you need to point out the critical fact that the income from royalties is totally under your control. You have no control whatsoever. It is totally dependent on the skill of the management team in the licensee company. And whether they succeed is highly dependent on what is going on in the market, which is largely out of their control. So to be judged on the income you bring in is something that's out of your control and unfair. Being judged on how many relationships you form is the key factor, and the benefit of them is something you need to communicate. Now, when you talk externally, nobody cares about how many patents you file, okay? Truly. They really don't. What they are very interested in is how your office and faculty are interacting with the community in terms of accelerators, incubators, government officials, investors. They'll be very curious to hear that, unlike the days when they went to college, there are student entrepreneurial hackathons, business plans, startups. These are the things that you need to be able to communicate to explain the benefits of what you're doing. You need to tell stories about your projects, not stories about your metrics. Stories about the benefit of the potential of what you're working on. The fact that there's a dengue fever diagnostic kit with a new variant out of the University of the Philippines to identify it early is a critically important thing to be able to communicate. The fact that it may not be in your university, irrelevant. The fact that it's being commercialized here in the country, totally relevant. These are the things that all of you need to have on the tip of your tongues, and if you don't, as a community, you need to gather the stories and make them available. Because you'll be asked, why am I paying you a salary? Why are you paying for patents? Why bother about what it is that you're doing? You need to have an answer. So you need to communicate the impact and the value, not the day-to-day things of what you do. And of course, the president and your bosses are curious about the income versus costs, and I'm going to address that in a minute. Okay, now here's the broader context that will help you. Research is recognized as a public good everywhere around the globe. And the only question is how much money we're going to spend from society on it. That's it. recognize it being good things. This is a critical slide. The people you talk to have expectations. You need to understand the words they use when they hear about research on campuses. They have high hopes that the research will generate increased growth in the country, drive stability, welfare development, better society, offer competitive advantage to the corporations, and often go hand in hand with political declarations that society needs more innovations. Well, these are the things that you need to talk about. When you talk to an outsider about patents, their eyes will glaze over and they will not listen to you. When you talk to them about the benefit of what you're doing in terms of these words, it can be very, very interesting. And you begin to build an understanding for better financial support for what you're doing. So you need to be able to communicate and respond to the high hopes to generate these items in terms of a story or two of projects that you're working on in your campus. And we saw the pitch this morning. I was absolutely fascinated, really impressed by the inventiveness of the people presenting. It was terrific. These are the stories you need to have. Okay. You're going to be asked about, at some point, what's the return on investment of all this money we're putting into research? And when you hear this, you need to be very careful. You need to tell the person, what you're really asking me is, what is the financial return on the financial investment? But don't forget the non-financial returns of the financial investment, in terms of employment, in terms of student education, in terms of a whole variety of things. You need to talk about impact, but you need to talk about eventual income. Don't shy away from it, but it can't be the total focus point. Now, copy down the name Edwin Mansfield. You need to go find his publication, because Mansfield provided the American government with a justification for doing research in terms of benefits to society. His work was replicated by two other researchers in the United States. For a period of time, Mansfield was the rationale for the expenditure of public money on research. You need to know about this. Here's why. He determined through studies that when industry invested in innovations that they took into the marketplace, they got an average of 25% financial return on their investment. But he demonstrated that the return and impact within the society, employment, further investment, what have you, was at least twice that. So when the public sector invests in the university and is transferred out, the impact on society is twice what the company spends to bring it into the marketplace. These are proven facts. This is the type of thing you need to be able to say, you know, studies have been done that show there's huge benefits to doing this, whether the project succeeds or not. So Edwin Mansfield, now passed away, but you can find his publication. Again, use stories, vignettes, whatever you want to call them. Better World Report at Autumn has at least 600. Look, I'm Canadian, okay? I live in the United States. Everyone's talking about how great the American system of technology transfer is. Okay? Yeah, it is. It truly, truly is. It's dynamic, but it's unique in the world. Because an immense economy that can put up with a tremendous amount of failure and proceed. The story I like to tell is the first recorded academic technology transfer, the first one recorded, occurred in Canada. It was at the University of Toronto, and it was insulin. Who here has heard of insulin? Anyone heard of insulin? Everybody. It was commercialized by an American corporation, Eli Lilly, that was only 45 years old at the time. And as you saw, there was a 5% royalty. fix that, please? You're keeping track of the staying right to reduce it, don't you? It's unfortunate, but there's a big technical glitch. Okay. So, let me, further 40% of the licenses are signed 7 years after the patent is filed, and the remainder are longer than that. That's only to the signing of the license. If it's a pharmaceutical drug, there's at least another 8 years of product development. If it's a piece of software, it's at least 2 years. So you add all this up, and you realize this takes a long time. And there were complaints earlier on about time to file and issue a patent, okay? Waste of time, irrelevant conversation, totally irrelevant. Why? Because corporations are interested in the innovation, whether it's protected or not. If they can be convinced that patent is coming, great. The real key behind all this is the fact that you have sought intellectual property protection. Okay, the fact that it takes long, that's okay. A question was asked about, can we hurry this up because of the faculty member and get them a benefit? Well, the real issue is, the time frames involved with patents and patent issue is kind of short compared to the research career of the faculty member, which is at least 30 or 40 years. So I'm not trying to trivialize this, I'm trying to give you guys ammunition when these arguments and complaints come up. That you should have at the tip of your tongue. I think I'm close to being done here. Well, maybe you're going to be here all night. All right. Return on investment. I referred to this a bit earlier, but I want to chat about this for just a minute because there are arguments in the United States about this sort of thing, and people are finding that they're talking about the wrong thing. Now, return on investment, there's the formula, financial return over the financial investment. Do not use royalties as a financial return alone. Okay? Use royalties plus research contracts, plus the corporate investment in equity in the startups, and all of a sudden you bring a much broader understanding to the table. When you look at the denominator, do not use all R&D expenditures. Simply use the patent expenses and the office expenses. For those of you in the back of the room, it'll be familiar stuff to you, even though it's a little hard to understand. Be very careful about your metrics, because what you can measure, what you might be measuring is what you can measure as opposed to what you should be measuring. I will tell you the autumn community made a major mistake talking about gross income that became the measurement of success in America, of a tech transfer office. We really screwed up. So we backed up, and you need to understand. There was an article in The Economist that said successful healthcare in Africa is being measured by the number of beds available, because it's measurable. What really needs to be talked about is the degree of the effectiveness of primary care preventing people from needing those hospital beds. So all I'm saying is, when people say, what is the benefit, be very careful that you don't get caught up in things that are easy to talk about and measure as opposed to what you should be talking about. I've got a slide here, which won't come up for some weird reason. How many here are members of the autism organization? Raise your hands. Okay. Autism has some fantastic statistics that you need to be aware of as part of your communication plan. Did you know that only 25% of disclosures in America are licensed? I took this into an MBA program at the university a number of years ago, and they laughed. I said, this is a great business model. They laughed me out of the room. You need to understand that in America, which supposedly is the gold standard, only 25% of the disclosures get licensed. When I talked to my friend Kathy Koo at Stanford a number of years ago, she said, you know, John, we're in the middle of the Silicon Valley. We've had an office that's been in place 40 years. We know what we're doing. But I need to tell you, that while we market every disclosure, I know I have a hot deal when two companies are interested. Most disclosures is actually no interest whatsoever. This is Stanford in the middle of the Silicon Valley after 40 years of experience. You need to understand that. So when you're struggling and worried about why you're not doing deals, relax. One of the best places on the globe is having a really difficult time in the middle of the Silicon Valley, for goodness sakes. And then she went on and said, you know, 17% of the licenses that we do return revenue, in terms of royalties, that is absolutely no more than the patent costs of that project. So what's the return on investment? 1 to 1. It's terrible. This is Stanford. So the data that you don't see that I'm telling you is available at Autumn, which gathers stories, statistics like this that you can use to share. So when people say, you know, it's American, only works well over there, and the answer is, A, it doesn't really work all that well over there. We're making it work here. We've got stories. We've got momentum. The government understands it. It takes a bit of time, that's true, but we have stories of technologies actually being transferred. So, in summary, to wrap it up, you need to start talking. We were talking, the pitches this morning were all about technologies and what they were doing to commercialize it. Everyone had 4 minutes. Everybody made the same mistake. They took 10 seconds to talk and 4 minutes to talk about the benefits of what they're doing. And wasted their time talking about everything else. They should have started and said, there was one project which I love, which was the use of traditional Filipino knowledge to improve the daily life of people with cancer disease based on traditional knowledge. That's what they should have started talking about. So, again, what you need to talk about is not how hard you're working, you don't have enough money, nobody cares, truly, because everyone's in the same boat. You need to be inspired by the fact that what you're working on can really change the world. Because for kidney patients, this homegrown traditional knowledge can improve people's lives. So you've got the stories. So you need to talk about the impact. You as a community need to get together and document, do a number of case studies, have a number of students do it. Edwin Mansfield, don't read the paper, it's highly technical, but the result is The societal benefit is twice what industry invests. Okay? That's important for your government to understand that you're part of the process that leads to that investment where the company benefits, but the benefit to society is twice as large. You need to have stories, and it'll all be blunt. If you expect to keep your job, you need to be able to justify what you do by talking about the value you're adding. You need to do this constantly because what you do takes a long time to come to fruition. So you need to talk about progress along the pathway to continue to have people support you. Once you have a success, you need to talk about it. Once you have a failure, you need to learn from it and talk about it as well. So what I wanted to do was not talk about creating knowledge, but keeping your jobs. And more importantly, talking about the success of your ITSO or KTTO while you're working towards these projects that will actually benefit people. I had a friend who told me, I got so deeply involved in my job, I forgot to communicate the benefits of what I was doing, and I got fired. So these are important lessons that I've learned over the years that I want to leave with you, that part of your job responsibility that you have is having the ammunition to explain to people why what you're doing is so important based on examples at other universities, your own university, to justify the value that you're ultimately adding. And at the end of the day, your president needs to have these stories at the tip of his or her tongue, and that's important. So I want to close and just simply say, these are the type of things I wanted to leave with you. We haven't talked about it because that wasn't the point of the Synergy Conference this year. But it's incredibly important and part of the lessons I've learned over the years. So thank you very much.